Good morning. Thank you for joining us today on our Facebook Live of our Calvary Assembly of God morning service. We're located at 110 Fruitland Avenue in Buell, Idaho. If you are in the area, we have small groups, Sunday school at 10 a.m., and our church service starts 11 a.m. So come join us any Sunday or during any other event that we have. We have a special guest speaker today, Brother Lyle Dieter, who's speaking today and will bless us with his message. Anyway, thanks for joining us and stay tuned.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning to you all.
I love you so much. I love you.
Good morning, Doug. There's a women's Bible study starting. Make sure you get plugged into that. Friday, when?
September 8th.
September 8th, thank you.
Yes, there it is on the previous page. I missed. Pastors will have been on their vacation. They're coming back on the 28th, which is
tomorrow.
Okay, and one other question, or not question, but comment, if you can, I do have, Will said he would, and Isaac is going to help. Pastor Royer and Rhonda, thank you. I'm sure glad that none of you have this problem, that you can't remember this problem. They're actually coming to get their stuff out of storage next week. They'll be here on Tuesday, loading Tuesday afternoon, I think they said, and then Wednesday afternoon, then they're taking and driving two Penske trucks back to California. They have a place that they finally found that they could rent. And it was, so if you're able to help, that was my whole point. If you're able to help, if you're not able to,
he'll
help?
Yes,
okay. They're looking for young people with strong backs, not necessarily have to be strong-minded, just strong back. So, anyway. Yes. Their storage units are, you know, as you go into Filer, and that's those metal boxes there. They have a couple of storage in there. But anyway, more details to follow. But that'll be Tuesday afternoon sometime, and then Wednesday, they'll need help getting loaded up. So, yes. There's a sign-up sheet for next Sunday.
For something to eat after service.
We need people to sign up. Go look at that clipboard back there. Get signed up. All right, is that enough stuff? Okay. God bless you. We'd like to welcome you all here. We're glad you came. People are vacationing, and so we're happy for them. God bless you. Lord, we just pray that you would take us into a place this morning, Lord God, that we feel so close to you that we could just reach out and touch you, Lord, that you would meet our needs right here. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Thank you,
Lord, this morning. Hallelujah.
Woo! Praise the Lord.
Oh,
Thank you. Choices. The choices that we have to make decisions in our lives. And so, I have a question. So, how much information do you need before you make a decision? Do you look at good information and do you look at bad information? When you have choices, do you have to have four or five good choices and four or five bad choices before you can make a decision? Do you look at any information at all? Sometimes I make a decision without even thinking about it at all. I'll tell a little story about me and my wife. She might be embarrassed. So I didn't clue her in on this first. And so I was at the store, and she liked to cook her breakfast or cook her bacon in the morning. So I was at the store and I said, "Man, they raised the price on this bacon." I said, "We need to buy the bacon over in Cash and Carry, because it's a lot better deal. $22, I can get this big, huge 5 pounds of bacon. It's a lot cheaper." And she looked at me and she said, "But that's not what I want. I like this bacon." So see, I was trying to make a decision without thinking about anything at all. I had choices. I had a choice to ask her about how she felt about it, but I didn't. I was just going to go ahead and do it the way that I wanted to do it, without considering anything whatsoever. And so do you use your mind, your will or your mind or emotions when you make decisions? So sometimes I use my mind. Sometimes I might be emotionally happy and I just make a decision and I don't think about anything else. I might be really sad. Sometimes we're emotional and we make decisions. So what kind of choices do we have? We have choices every time we make a decision. You made a choice to follow Jesus. Maybe you did, maybe you didn't. Maybe it was forced upon you. Maybe somebody opened you up and just poured it in. And you didn't have no choice whatsoever. And so, go back one more, please. So when you, and the decisions, so when you look at those choices, do you kind of weigh those to see how they're going to affect your life? When I made the decision about the bacon, I didn't think about, would I be in trouble? How would that affect my life from here on out? Would I have to hear about these things every day? I told you, I don't like that bacon. I told you that's not the bacon that I want. Why do you keep cooking it for me? And so sometimes I use those when I think about a decision that I need to make when it deals with God. But I don't know that I look into my heart and ask my heart, how do I really feel inside of my body? That's what it's really about, right? So Smith Wigglesworth discusses it pretty good. It's a daily devotional called Divinely Adjusted. And he says that this is where the Spirit resides, is in your heart. So your decisions come from your heart. They go to your mind. Your mind reflects upon those from your heart. And then your mouth is operated. He said the most dangerous situation is when you reverse the order. When your mouth operates without anything from your mind and nothing from your heart. That's where we get ourselves into trouble. And so, here Jesus is talking to the Pharisees. And the Pharisees had a choice in life. So in verse, it starts at verse John 8:39. So they answered and said to him, "Abraham, is our Father. Jesus said to them that if if you were Abraham's children, you would do the works of Abraham. But now you seek to kill me, a man who told you the truth which I heard from God. Abraham did not do this. You do the deeds of your father. So he's setting them up, trying to tell them that you made a choice. You say that your father is Abraham, and you do the things of Abraham. But Abraham never attempted to kill God or come against God or anything. He did exactly what he was told to do. Then they said to him, "We were not born of fornication. We have one Father, God." Jesus said to them, "If God were your Father, you would love me, for I proceed forth and came from God, nor have I come of myself, but he sent me. Why do you not understand my speech? Because you are not able to listen to my word. You are of your father, the devil, and the desires of your father you want to do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and he does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him." So they made a decision. Jesus came to them and told them, "This is the word from God. God gave me this word, and I'm giving it to you." But they made a choice. They weighed that, and they did. They did not like Jesus. They wanted to kill Jesus. They plotted to kill him. And that came from them. And so he's telling them, you can only serve one master. You can only make one decision when it comes to that. You either serve God or you serve the enemy. If you're not serving the Lord, then you're serving the devil. Jesus' own words to the Pharisees. And so, also, how do we serve Jesus? Where does that come from? Jesus sent the helper, which resides in our heart. So if Jesus is not in here, then who are we? How do we make decisions based on what God has given us or Jesus has spoken to our lives? If the Holy Spirit doesn't reside in here, then how is it possible we can make a decision that's not of the enemy? Romans 10:10. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness. So a lot of the word that came from Paul and some of Jesus' own words talks about the heart, where the Spirit resides in the heart, and how we weigh those things when we make decisions. Right? The choices that we have. Romans 8:5. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. So now we're looking at the flesh. So if we live according to the flesh, then I don't know if the Holy Spirit reside in our heart and we're still living in the flesh. If we're saved and the Holy Spirit was given to us and resides in our heart, but we're living in the flesh, how is that possible? Because we made the choice just to shut down that Holy Spirit in our heart, just put it in a box, keep it there, and only use it when we need it. Draw upon it to make the decisions, look at the choices, but if we're living in the flesh, and that is not of God. But if we're living of the Spirit, and the things of the Spirit, and the Holy Spirit resides in our heart, Second Corinthians. Second Corinthians 1:21-22. Now he who establishes us with you in Christ has anointed us in God, who also has sealed us up and given us the Holy Spirit in our hearts as a guarantee. So when we were saved, the Holy Spirit was given to us in our heart so that we can use the Holy Spirit for our life. Galatians 4:6-7. And so these are all under the New King James. And because you are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of His Son into your hearts, crying out, Abba, Father. Therefore you are no longer a slave, but a son, and if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. So again, he's reconfirming that we are heirs of Christ. We have the Holy Spirit residing inside of us. And we are to do what God has given us, to direct us, to live for Him. Romans 8:6. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. So, if I'm making decisions with my mind and not seeking the Holy Spirit and asking the Holy Spirit to give me those choices and to weigh them heavily on my heart, then I may be carnally minded because I'm thinking of things of the world, but I'm not letting the Holy Spirit move inside to help me make those decisions, help me live for God. I don't know how I could live for God properly without seeking the Holy Spirit first, if the Holy Spirit is in my heart. Somehow I do it. I go back to that bacon. Somehow I didn't ask God. I didn't say, God, give me the right decision here. Should I just buy this bacon anyway? But I didn't. I didn't ask God to help me make that decision. No matter how important it is, somehow I let my mind make some decisions, and I don't even weigh the choices sometimes. Sometimes my mouth makes the choice for me, and things just come out. And sometimes I have to be reminded of those things. Rosa reminds me, why did you say that? So maybe that's the Holy Spirit moving through her for that ounce of correction that I need when my mouth is operating and it didn't come from my heart. Because somehow I should stop and think about that every single time before my mouth says anything whatsoever. Romans 8:7-8. So because of the carnal mind is enmity against God, or is not subject to the law of God, nor indeed can it be. So then, those who are in the flesh cannot please God. So when I think about that, I think about enmity. I had to look this one up. The state of feeling of being actively opposed or hostile towards someone or something. So, because of the carnal mind, it's hostile against God. If I have a carnal mind, it's so displeasing to God, it's hostile towards God. So every time that my mind thinks about things that are not of God or the Holy Spirit, then I'm opposing or being hostile towards God. So I should probably remember that next time when my mind is thinking about something, about how displeasing it is to God and how hostile I'm coming against God. And then peace. Can you go back one? And so peace, I thought I knew what peace is, but there's a nice definition. It's the resolution of the internal warfare as well as in the world, as in the word, harmony and tranquility that results from yielding to God. So I thought that was pretty good. The resolution of the internal or the intense warfare as it is in the word. So an intense battle. So I need peace in my heart so that there's not that. And I go back to what John said to the Pharisees about, if you seek to kill me, then you are not of me or of my father. You are serving your father, the devil. So I really have to think about that. Then Paul writes, which I'm sure some of you are very familiar with this, Romans 7:15, this is one part of it. For what I am doing, I do not understand. For what I will to do, that I do not practice. But what I hate, that I do. It's almost an enigma. Right? What is the true meaning? So, for what I am doing, things that I'm doing right now, the things that I'm doing all the time, I do not understand. Sometimes I do things or I say things, particularly when they come from my mind or from my heart, I may not understand them, they just come out. And it's probably not what I want to say, and it's probably not what I want to do, and I probably didn't seek God for the answer before I ever said it or did it. And for what I will to do, that I do not practice. So I really want to serve God. I want the Holy Spirit moving inside of my life to the point that it's so overwhelming, I spend most of the time not even being able to speak right. And anybody around me can see that. And I'm sure that you've all been there before. When the Holy Spirit is upon you and you feel it, there's such an overwhelming sense of God flowing through you at that point in time. And it's almost unbearable. Sometimes you just have to lay down, sit down, because it's so overwhelming. But we can't be that way all the time. Because if we were, we'd probably drive off the road. We'd probably do things that, because we can't pay attention. It's so overwhelming, you just, boom, sometimes you're out. That's what I will to do. But do I practice that? I probably don't practice that every day. Do I read the word every day? Do I be in prayer every day? Do I treat my wife the way God wants me to treat her? The same way that I would treat Jesus? Do I spend every 18 minute in the word? Or do I just come to church on Sunday, sit in the pew, thank God that I'm saved. Thank God I don't have to do anything else, because God puts so much pressure on me to do all these other things that I'm not doing. And so I really thought about this, and I thought, you know, I don't want to be that kind of Christian. I don't know how I could properly serve God if the only time God was in my life is when I come to church and sit with you on Sunday. I would like to think that everyone around me knows how I serve the Lord and how important God is to me, that they would be so convicted that when they sit next to me or they talk to me and they say a foul word or they say something that's disgusting, they would apologize and say, oh, I didn't mean to offend you, I'm sorry. They should recognize that about me. The Holy Spirit should be working in front of me and I should be interrupting them and telling them, hey, you need to stop what you're doing right now. And don't talk that way around me, because that's, I don't like that. That does not reflect the kind of relationship that I have with Jesus. But I don't practice that. But what I hate, that I do. I think about those choices. I have the choice in my life that I could practice exactly what I want. When I read God's word, Jesus' own word said that I need to do this, then I need to do it. That's what I should be practicing all the time. Not everything else. But somehow it's like a faucet in the sink. I can just go turn it on when I need it. Turn it off when I'm done. And the rest of the time I spend somewhere in my mind and in my mouth. But what I hate, that I do. That is for sure. Maybe I'm the only one. But I struggle with these things. And I think about these things all the time. We have conversations about them. Why do you do that? Why do I feel this way? because of the things that you do. And sometimes it's a little bit honest when somebody will tell you, well, I thought you were a Christian. I thought you served the Lord. How is it possible that you could act this way or say those things or do these things? So then the second part of, if then I do what I will not to do, I agree with the law that it is good. Wow. So, if then I do what I will not to do, my will is to serve the Lord. If I do what I am not to do, if I don't do that, then I'm okay with the law. Well, maybe I'm reading it wrong, but that tells me that if I'm not serving the Lord Jesus Christ, then and the way that I'm supposed to be doing it, I'm not saved, I'm not doing those things, I'm going to burn in hell. But I'm okay with that because the law says that's it. Jesus' own words told the Pharisees that you're not allowed to serve two masters. You can only serve one. You either serve the God or you're serving the devil. And you're of the Father. Your father is the devil because you seek to kill him. Abraham and anybody who believes that would never do that. So the last part, so when I think about all these things wrapped up, then I think about this, that I need to identify with myself. This is something that we got from a Thrive convention down in Roseville, California. They have a class that they teach this, and it takes 28 weeks to go through the class, and it's for new believers. And they say that very first thing, before you can impact anybody's life, before you can have any skill, before you can understand anything at all, you have to identify with who you are. So when I think about that, here's one little part of my life that I need to identify with. Jesus' own words told me that you have to have the Holy Spirit in your heart. And when you're saved, you made a choice. You were someplace in your life and things were generally bad. I don't know that anybody's celebrating, won the lottery. Woo! Yeah! Look at me! I got $1 million! I'm going to go give my life to God. Chances are not. The chances are you were at one of the lowest points in your life, and that's when you really start to seek the Lord. And somebody was put into your life and for that time and place to speak into you that you need to serve the Lord Jesus Christ. And you need to give your life to God's perfect timing. And so when I think about those things, it's a self-examination. Can I identify with who I am in Christ? It makes perfect sense to seek a deeper sense of myself, to become intimately aware of my thoughts, feelings, hopes, and fears. The key is to engage myself, my sense of self. So I need to identify with who I am in Christ. I need to identify with that Holy Spirit that's moving in my heart. And I need to follow the simple rules that Jesus Christ said, look, let the Holy Spirit move through your life and do these things. And seek only me. Serve only me. Don't serve the enemy. There's a little common thing after this that says, you need to be like the willow. And you need to be strong and you can just waver with the winds and the things that come into your life. If you're like the oak, strong and stiff, you're going to crack. So that tells me that in my life, I have to consider those things. I have to be able to bend with things. I like things in a very straight and analytical manner. When I don't understand something, I like gathering facts. I like reading manuals. I like doing certain things to base my decisions on them. But very, very seldom do I ever ask God for the answer first. Sometimes I like to think that God gave me those things. He gave this to me to use to make those decisions. So I can weigh those choices and I can make those decisions on my own. Maybe I don't need to bother God all the time. God, you know, make sure that you send me in the right direction. Because some of the things that I do, some of the decisions that I make, they affect the lives that are around me as well, particularly my wife. I've made decisions that have affected our life, and they have been bad decisions. And they've affected our life for a long time. And so when you do those things, it's very difficult to repair that relationship sometimes. And if you continue to make those over and over, then there's a place right here where you can get your answers. Right? Because Jesus' own word said, you got to seek me first. You got to ask me first. He has to be in your heart. And you have to allow him to move in your heart. You have to seek him. Let him give you the answers that you're looking for. I had a dream one time. There was something that was going on in our lives, and I was just sick about it. And I was just, I went to bed thinking about it so much, and I just, man, I really got to understand how to fix this problem. And in a dream, it came to me. I had the answer. I was so happy. I was just jumping up and I don't know if I was actually moving. But in my dream, I was jumping up and down. Woo, I know the answer. Yeah, that's great. When I got up in the morning, forgot. I couldn't remember. I still don't remember to this day. I'd have woke up if I could have and wrote it down. I guess it just wasn't meant to be. Yeah. So we're going through a time of prayer. If you need prayer for anything, if God's dealing with you in your life right now, and you need some help dealing with the choices that you have in life, you can come up for prayer. You have a prayer song? Steve does. He's going to play the guitar. But if you need prayer for anything else, you're welcome to come up for prayer during this song. We can certainly have the prayer team come up and pray for you. But maybe you're all good. I don't know about you, but I don't think I could spend the next 30 minutes listing all the things that I need prayer. It's not just for me. Sometimes it's for my family. Sometimes it's for our children and our grandchildren. As they struggle in life, as they don't see the clarity of the Holy Spirit wanting to move in their life, as they don't seek God first for the answers that they need. So sometimes we have to stand in for them and pray for them as well, saying, God, just put someone in their life. The hardest thing for a child to do, which we are children of God, that's an interesting concept. Do your kids listen to you? Do your kids take your advice? Do they do exactly what you tell them? No, because they have their own free will to do whatever they want. Your mom's down here shaking her head at you.
I know.
And so you think about that. There's God the Father up above looking at his children, wondering why his children aren't doing what he told them to do. chair. As Steve continues to play, we'll take the tithes and offering. And ask the ushers to come forward, please.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us this afternoon. We appreciate it. Go and tell someone God loves them this week. If you have any prayer requests, you can send them to me or Pastor Matt's inbox and messenger. God bless you and have a great week. Again, we're located at 110 Fruitland Avenue in Buell, Idaho. So if you're in the area, come and join us again at 10 a.m. for small groups, Sunday school, or both, or at 11 a.m. for the church service. Again, God bless you and have a wonderful week. Thanks again.